Hello, and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about the growing pains of database architecture at Figma, as well as alternate architectures, such as the sharding architecture chosen by Notion. This is a blog post by Tim from the Figma engineering team earlier this year. In this blog post, they describe how Figma, back in 2020, hit some growing pains where they needed to figure out how to continue scaling. Figma's infrastructure, in particular in regards to metadata like permissions, file information, and comments, is all built on Postgres. Back then, they actually had a single large Amazon RDS database that persisted that type of metadata. And the problem that they encountered back then was that they observed upwards of 65% CPU utilization during peak traffic, and they weren't really sure how to deal with that. Now, they looked at different approaches on how to solve this. First of all, back then, they still had some headroom in terms of which instance type to use. They were on a very large, very expensive R5 12x large, but they essentially doubled that to an R5 24x large just to maximize that CPU utilization runway, because that for them really was the big issue. Then they looked into creating read replicas to scale the read traffic, as well as establishing new databases for new use cases so that they don't keep adding into that same central database. And last, they added pgbouncer as a connection pooler. And so all of these changes, they're very common. They all, in my experience, make a lot of sense as you're scaling. But in their situation, even though they made these changes, they still had limitations because they still had everything going to that central database. They were thinking about different options they could choose. And as you decide how you can scale Postgres, one of the things they, of course, considered is, should we be going to something else? Should we be going to a Postgres-compatible solution that lets you just run multiple nodes? Back then, in their assessment, none of the options really made sense. They didn't want to be the first customers that hit certain scaling issues. They didn't want to lose control of managed solutions. And so they didn't really feel comfortable going with some of the options out there, like GigabyteDB or CockroachDB. What they instead ended up doing is they decided to partition the data. Now, what they mean with partitioning here is not the same as local table partitioning on a single node. But what they're referring to is that different tables are on different servers. And so they split up the type of data on each database server. They compared this with horizontal sharding. Now, horizontal sharding would be closer to what Notion did a couple of years ago, where they described their lessons learned from sharding Postgres at Notion. Notion has a similar problem where a lot of data, even more than the data in Figma's case, is stored in Postgres. And so they were trying to figure out how to scale that. Now, Notion's approach back then was really well described in this blog post, but I think this diagram here summarizes this well. In Notion's case, they had this one monolith, and they essentially moved into, back then, 32 physical database servers. And really what they did is the same kind of schema exists in multiple locations. So you have a block, a space, and a comment, and they are on each physical database server. In Figma's case, they decided to do something else. They decided that they did not want to do horizontal sharding, but instead what they wanted to do is partition the tables based on certain use cases. They were trying to assess this based on two criteria. The first was determining the impact, but they wanted to make sure that the tables that they were moving off of that big monolith database into other servers, that actually were significant portions of the workload. And second, they wanted to make sure these tables are isolated. As you're doing this, one of the biggest challenges are going to be joins or any other kind of dependencies between tables. And so in this particular case, what they look for is those two properties so that they would identify tables that are independent, yet still having a big impact. They ended up sampling pieces of activity in 10 millisecond intervals to identify the CPU weights with each query. And then they aggregate that information by table name. They were trying to say which queries are impacting which tables and how much of the overall load is that. And through that, understand which table has the most impact. Understanding how isolated tables are is tricky. What they ended up doing here was actually adding some application side telemetry where they tried to understand which logic in the application used which models together versus which ones were executed more independently. Once they figured that out, they aimed for a solution that has low downtime. What I found interesting here is that they ended up going with a combination of pgbouncer and logical replication. This is a good example of where logical replication can really shine, which lets you move data from one server to another while staying online. And you don't have to move the whole database. You can actually say, let me pick this table or even a subset of this table in your Postgres versions. Let me logically replicate that to the other server and then do a cutover. And so they built some tooling around that. Ultimately, and I think this is very impressive, they ended up being able to move most of these high traffic tables and split things up. And usually when they did these moves, they only saw a 30-second downtime on their availability on these tables that they were moving. 30 seconds is not zero, but for something that is essentially a bespoke tooling around a core Postgres feature such as logical replication, I think that is pretty good. And presumably if you iterated on a tooling further, you could reduce down the 30-second period. Generally speaking, when you consider how you scale Postgres, these two choices, in the case of Figma, partitioning the data vertically onto different servers, or in the case of Notion, doing horizontal sharding on the application side, the two popular choices that work well. Both of them require application side changes, but I do think that they show how Postgres can scale even for the most demanding workloads. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week. Thank you.